Good morning, Utica. Glad to see everybody here today. Last night, I had the great privilege of taking part of my family to the OCA drama. Oconee Christian Academy is doing the drama this weekend, and we have a couple of our youth who are in the drama. Amber Ellis is in it, as well as Brianne Argo. And it was very entertaining. If you have an afternoon free today and would like to help support that school and be entertained as well, I would recommend that you get some tickets up at the Walhalla Civic Center, 2:30 this afternoon. It'll be a great investment of your time, great way to support this Christian school. So why am I talking about that? Well, the play itself was called Touchstone M for Murder. You might recognize that title a little spin off of Dial M for Murder, but just a whodunit throughout the night. And it confirmed once again in my life that I'm glad I'm not a detective, because my detective skills are not very good. Had some guesses throughout the night. Never did a very good job of figuring out who it was that committed the murder. We are continuing to study in the weeks leading up to Easter the most brutal and devastating murder in the history of the world, and that is the murder of Jesus Christ. This is not like Touchstone M for Murder in that we have to try to figure out who it was that was responsible for it. As we read in Acts chapter 2 in the first Christian sermon, listen to these words that Peter shares with the crowd there at Pentecost. He says, "This Jesus delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, this Jesus you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men." One thing I love about that verse is it gives us both perspectives of the murder of Jesus Christ. It reminds us at the beginning of that verse, as we talked about last week, that ultimately God was sovereign. And Jesus did not just die because there were some wicked men who had a wicked plan, but this was all part of God's plan. So I love how Peter reminds his listeners of the divine plan of God, that the death of Jesus, now we need to hear this, church, because I think sometimes we forget this, the death of Jesus was plan A. It was not plan B. It wasn't God saying, "Oh goodness, these people that I have created have sinned against me. What am I ever going to do about it?" The Bible tells us that Jesus Christ was slain before the foundations of the world. This was plan A. But I love how Peter said, even though this was plan A, and even though God sovereignly determined that Jesus would die at Calvary, it does not remove the culpability of those wicked men who were involved, and it doesn't remove our culpability either. He died at the hands of lawless men, and he died because of lawless men and women and boys and girls. Just like all of us would fit into that category. Well, one of the things that we're doing in the weeks leading up to Easter is I want us to look each week at one of those lawless men that was involved in the murder of Jesus. This week we'll be looking at Caiaphas, the high priest. He is the second member of our jury, as we're talking about over these next few weeks. Last week we looked at the life of Judas Iscariot and the part that he played in the betrayal of Jesus, kind of setting into motion that divine plan of God for the crucifixion of Jesus. But today we're going to be looking at Caiaphas the high priest. Now, if you are like most people in a Protestant background especially, neither of those names probably really jumps out on the page of you. Either his actual name, Caiaphas, we actually know from historical documents it was Joseph Caiaphas. So you may not recognize that name very much, and you're probably not too familiar with his role as the high priest. So before we get to the scriptures today, just a little bit of background so that we know kind of where we're going. Caiaphas presided over the Sanhedrin. And the Sanhedrin, these are my words here, my summary is that the Sanhedrin is kind of like the Jewish Supreme Court. This is all the religious leaders who would come together to make religious decisions. And the main passage that we're going to be looking at this morning, Matthew 26 and 27, follows Jesus the night before his crucifixion and follows him to several different trials. To begin with, he has religious trials where he stands before Annas and then Caiaphas. And then he has some political and legal trials as well where he stands before Herod and Pilate. And we'll look at those guys the next couple of weeks. But basically, the high priest was the main leader of the Jewish people. He was the main leader of the religious people of Jerusalem. He presided over the temple, and he also presided over the Sanhedrin, which is the Jewish version of the Supreme Court. And Caiaphas ruled as the high priest from A.D. 18 to 36. Now, a couple of notes about that. It's interesting that even though officially the office of the high priest was a lifetime office, just like our Supreme Court carries with it a lifetime appointment, even though there was this lifetime appointment officially, what we actually see happening in these particular years in the first century under the hand of the Romans is that the high priest didn't rule all that long. Now, they may have had the official title for their entire lives, but basically, the high priest served at the pleasure of the Roman government. And the people leading up to Caiaphas, the three or four high priests immediately preceding him, ruled for about 1 year each. So you can see, here's this 18 or 19-year rule. So we know that Caiaphas is a very influential man. He has a lot of power in this area, and he is the son-in-law to the legitimate high priest. As you're reading through the Gospels, if you don't kind of know the backstory here, you might get a little bit confused because sometimes we read about Annas the high priest, and sometimes we read about Caiaphas the high priest. Well, here's the story behind that. Like I said, the high priest was a lifetime appointment, and Annas was still alive. So he was legitimately the high priest, and he was the father-in-law of this Joseph Caiaphas. Those three or four people that I said ruled before Caiaphas did, those were his brother-in-laws. Those were Annas' sons who were put into that position when Rome took Annas out of that position. And as best we can tell from the extra-biblical historical documents is that Annas was removed from that position by the Romans, most likely from the predecessor to Pontius Pilate. He was removed because he actually carried out a death sentence as the high priest. That was a no-no. The Jewish system, the religious leaders, were allowed to carry out discipline within their members, but they were not allowed to execute anybody. And so Annas had carried out the death penalty, and because of that, Pontius Pilate's predecessor had removed him from office. So one after the other, his three sons got their shot at ruling. But apparently they didn't do very well because they lasted about a year each, and then finally they put the son-in-law, Caiaphas, in the position where he lasted for 18 or 19 years. And as you can hear from all of that, you might be able to fill in the blank for yourself on that last bullet point, that the high priest was appointed by the Romans for what reasons? Political purposes. That's right. It's amazing how the more things change, the more things stay the same, right? So here is this religious leader, the highest religious leader in the land, and yet he was appointed for political purposes. Basically, he was, for all intents and purposes, a puppet of the Roman governor, particularly Tiberius. Listen to what Bill O'Reilly says in his book, Killing Jesus, which I have found to be actually pretty historically accurate as it relates to these events. O'Reilly says, few people in Jerusalem realize that the same man who leads the rite for the atonement of sin is a dear friend of Rome and the decadent emperor Tiberius. So the high priest, even though it was a religious position, was appointed for political purposes. So what is it that we can not just learn about Caiaphas, because this is not ever intended to be a Bible history lesson. It's not doing us any good if we just know a few more things about Caiaphas and his life and even about the life of Jesus. God doesn't want us to know more stuff in each of those events. He wants us to learn from that stuff. He wants us to be able to walk more closely with Jesus based on what we see in the gospel. So what are some lessons that we can learn as we look at the life of Caiaphas the high priest? We're going to spend most of our time this morning in Matthew 26 and 27, primarily Matthew 26. We'll spend a good bit of the time in that one passage where Jesus is before Caiaphas, the high priest. But we're actually going to get an introduction to Caiaphas in John chapter 11. So if you want to turn there in your scriptures, you are more than welcome to. If not, you can just follow along on the screen. But this is actually one of our first introductions to who Caiaphas is, and certainly the first thing that I think the first major thing that we can glean from his life. So listen to what John says as he is describing to us the aftermath of the raising of Lazarus. If you're not familiar with the story, a dear friend of Jesus, Lazarus, with his sisters Mary and Martha, Lazarus had passed away. They had sent for Jesus earlier because they wanted Jesus to come and heal Lazarus. And the Bible tells us that because he loved them so much, he tarried, he waited, and he allowed Lazarus to pass away. And as we know, the end of the story, Jesus comes and he raises Lazarus from the dead. Well, as you can imagine, that brought a lot of attention. Because it's hard to fake somebody being raised from the dead. If the religious leaders are there and the community members are there and they see him die and they see him put in the tomb and one day passes and 2 days passes and 3 days passes and 4 days, they pretty much know that Lazarus is dead. And then along comes Jesus and out comes Lazarus. And so as you can imagine, there was a great stir in the community. Some were quite impressed. Some probably would not have used that particular term. So let's see what we read about Caiaphas and his little group. It says in verse 47, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered a council and said, "What shall we do? For this man works many signs." I'm going to get in the right translation here. Verse 48 says, "If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him. And the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation." So this is Caiaphas saying, listen, we got a problem on our hands. Jesus has done something that we can't explain away. Jesus has done something that's caught the attention of the people. And if we don't do something, we're going to be in trouble. You see, Caiaphas astutely recognized Jesus' potential. He realized there's something going on with this man. And although his following may not be quite as large yet, we know that if he continues to do the things that he's doing now, and if the people continue to flock to him and see his miraculous power and hear his teaching, we're going to be in trouble. Caiaphas astutely recognized Jesus' potential, and here's the lesson for us, and its threat to his own way of life. He recognized that if Jesus continued unchecked, that life was going to change for Caiaphas. He was going to lose his position. He realized he was a political appointment, to say the least. And he realized, I'm going to get in trouble. I might lose my power. I might lose my control. I might lose my comfortable way of life. Now, why can we learn from that? Because every one of us needs to recognize Jesus' potential in our life. And we need to recognize that we cannot continue to learn about Jesus and follow Jesus without our life radically changing. If we think that we can just take Jesus and kind of just add him to the list, Just add him to the benefits that we have in our life. Just add him to our belief systems without knowing that he's going to radically change everything, then we haven't met the right Jesus. And we have not recognized his potential. So the first thing that we can glean from Caiaphas before any of this really comes to the forefront in the death of Jesus is that Caiaphas recognized this man Jesus must be dealt with. We must reckon with him on the terms of who he actually is. And look at what the summary is down in verse 53. It says, "So, as a result of what they recognized, from that day on, they made plans to put him to death." Now, I certainly hope that is not your conclusion as you deal with Jesus of Nazareth. I would hope that instead of trying to put Jesus out of your life, that you would put yourself to death. Surrender yourself to his life. But we certainly need to recognize Jesus' potential in our life. Now, fast forward to Matthew chapter 26. This is when the action begins to happen during Holy Week. This is the same passage that we looked primarily at last week as we looked at Judas Iscariot and his betrayal of Jesus. We see that Caiaphas is right in on that picture. As we pick up in verses 3 through 5 of Matthew chapter 26, this is a passage we read last week. It says, "The chief priests and the elders of the people gathered in the palace of the high priest, whose name was Caiaphas, and plotted together in order to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him. But, they said, not during the feast, lest there be an uproar among the people." So what we see here is that Caiaphas, he's continuing to learn about this Jesus. And he's continuing to learn that he has more and more of a following. And even though he is as committed as ever to extinguishing the life of Jesus, he knows he has to be careful in how he does that. Because all these people have gathered together in Jerusalem for the Passover. And he knows that many of these disciples are friends of Jesus. They are fans of Jesus. They are followers of Jesus. And Caiaphas knows that if we don't have a plan to do this secretly, then the people are going to be in an uproar, and thus his job's going to be in jeopardy, because Rome doesn't want the people to be in an uproar. That really plays out, as we are going to see in Pilate's life, in a couple of weeks. So skip down to verses 57 to 65. This is when the action comes right to Caiaphas. So we're bypassing those events that we looked at last week, where Judas has arranged the betrayal. He has, in fact, betrayed Jesus. Jesus has spent the night in the Garden of Gethsemane praying about his submission to the Father. He has decided he's going to go through with the divine plan because he is committed to obedience. He is committed to carrying out this mission that God the Father has sent him for. So he said yes to the Father, and immediately after that, he has been arrested by the Jewish priests and the Roman soldiers. So pick the action up in verse 57. "Then those who had seized Jesus led him to Caiaphas the high priest, where the scribes and the elders had gathered. And Peter was following him at a distance, as far as the courtyard of the high priest. And going inside, he sat with the guards to see the end. Now the chief priests and the whole council," this is probably an informal meeting of the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin is not specifically noted here, so more than likely they may have been missing some members, or they may have seen it in their best interest to not consider this to be an official meeting of the Sanhedrin. Because if you start to look in the legalities for that, what you would see is they actually break a lot of their own laws in trying Jesus and questioning Jesus and coming to a decision. But we can probably understand this to be an informal meeting of the Sanhedrin. The chief priests and the whole council, notice what they were doing. They were seeking false testimony against Jesus that they might put him to death. Early in the week, if you had asked me what is the summary sentence for what we can learn about Caiaphas, my summary sentence would have been, Caiaphas was willing to bend the truth and break the law in order to get what he wanted. And that's not in your notes anywhere. That's for free. But that's a great note for us, right? Are you willing to bend the truth and to break the law in order to get what you want? Are you willing to do things in a way that God would not approve of? Because you recognize that if you follow through with Jesus' potential in your life, that your way of life is going to be threatened? I hope that we're not like Caiaphas in that particular way. So they're seeking this false testimony, and Matthew tells us right up front what the objective is, because they want to put Jesus to death. Verse 60 says, "But they found none, though many false witnesses came forward." So, summary sentence there, they're looking for somebody who's going to give them some dirt on Jesus that will lead them to a death sentence. And try as they might, no matter how many rules they were willing to ignore, no matter how much they were willing to bend the truth, up to this point in the trial, they had not found anything that would stick when they threw it against the wall. See, they knew that They knew that Pilate wasn't going to be interested in all this religious stuff that they were interested in. So they're looking for a trumped-up charge for Jesus, but as of this point, they have not found any. At last, two came forward and said, "This man said, I am able to destroy the temple of God and to rebuild it in 3 days." Now, if you are familiar with the gospel story, if you're familiar with the life and the ministry of Jesus, those words may sound familiar. They may sound like something that Jesus said. I remember the first time that I really dove into this passage, I remember thinking, well, why did they call those guys false witnesses? Because Jesus said that. Just goes to show you how prone we are to not paying careful attention to Scripture. Because even though Jesus said something like that, that is not what Jesus said. In fact, if we want to see what Jesus said, we can go back to John chapter 2. And we can look to see exactly what Jesus said as it related to the temple. It says, "The Jews said to him, what sign do you show us for doing these things?" Now, in this passage, the "these things" is that Jesus cleared the temple. He was not happy with all this religious activity that was taking place in the temple, devoid of any spiritual transformation. And so, as you know, Jesus cleared the temple. He turned over the money tables. He drove everybody out. The Jews, as you can imagine, did not care for that too much. And they said, "What sign do you show us for doing these things?" In other words, can you show me some ID, sir, and show me by whose authority you just did this? And Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." So notice carefully what Jesus said. He said, "You destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will build it up." And of course, at the end of verse 20, John lets us know that he was speaking about the temple of his body. He was not speaking about the edifice of the temple, that beautiful building that God's people would enter to worship him, but he was speaking about his body. But these two witnesses twisted his words and said that Jesus said, "I am able to destroy the temple of God and to rebuild it in 3 days." Verse 62, the high priest stood up. You can almost visualize Caiaphas to this point has been sitting over on the side, presiding over the meeting. And at this point, he stood up because he knows, aha, now we're getting somewhere. Now we're starting to approach something that can make some hay in this search to crucify Jesus. And so he stood up and he said, "Have you no answer to make? What is it that these men testify against you?" But Jesus remained silent. In fact, all throughout the Gospels, all four Gospel writers emphasize the silence of Jesus throughout the trial. Just as we read in Isaiah 53 that as a lamb led to the slaughter, that he would not open his mouth. What we see all throughout the Gospel accounts of these trials of Jesus is that Jesus did not speak up to defend himself. Over and over and over again, these charges were thrown at him, and Jesus remained silent. And what's interesting is that in the moments that Jesus does finally speak up, no matter which gospel you're looking at, Jesus actually speaks up not in a way to defend himself, but to further incriminate himself, to further clarify who he is and what he came to do. So pick it back up in verse 63. "But Jesus remained silent to these ridiculous charges, and the high priest said to him, 'I adjure you by the living God, tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God.'" It's almost as if Caiaphas says, "All right, enough with all this preliminary junk. Okay, we can talk about trumped up charges. We can talk about what you said and what you did. But it all boils down to, who are you, Jesus? You tell me, and you tell me the truth. Are you the Christ, the Son of God?" And Jesus said to him, "You have said so. It is just as you have said. But I tell you, from now on, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven. I'm not going to spend much time on that verse. I dealt with it extensively as we were preaching through Mark's gospel several months ago. But basically, this is Jesus saying, listen, yes, I am the Christ. Yes, I am the Son of the living God. And you might be a little bit confused about that right now because you see me in a very vulnerable position. You see me basically in the hands and at the disposal of my enemy, but mark my word, this is not how you're going to always see me. Because one of these days, you're going to see me coming on the clouds, and I'm going to be seated at the right hand of the Heavenly Father. I think that's part of Jesus saying, listen, you might have been seated presiding over this meeting, but one of these days, I'm going to be the one who is seated, and I'm going to be at the right hand of the Heavenly Father, and you're going to see me coming in the clouds. This is a reference to Daniel chapter 7, verse 13, and Psalm 110, verse 1, and it is unmistakably clear that Jesus is who He says He is. He is, in fact, the Son of God. Then the high priest tore his robes, and he said, He has uttered blasphemy. You see, the second lesson that we can learn from Caiaphas here is that he clearly understood Jesus' self-identity as fully God. Make no mistake about it. We may look to the Gospels, and we may look at the New Testament, and we might not find the specific wording on Jesus' lips that unequivocally says to us in a way that we understand, I am God. And we might look at the Gospels and make a conclusion that Jesus then never claimed to be God. But church, what I want you to hear this morning is we can't do that in light of the evidence. We can do that in light of our preconceived notions. We can do that in light of the arguments that we hear from outside the church. We can do that in light of the people all around us who might say, yes, Jesus is a great teacher. Jesus is a wonderful moral example. And Jesus came to teach us how to love one another. And all of that is true, but none of that is enough. Because Jesus is more than that. And He made it abundantly clear that He was more than that. So clear that the high priest, the highest religious leader of that day, clearly understood what Jesus was saying. So let me be clear in this. If you decide to go down that road, if you decide that the conclusion you want to make about Jesus is He's just another good teacher, and yes, we can learn to look to Him and learn from Him and follow His example, let me tell you two things about that. Number one, you are just flat out ignoring the evidence because Jesus clearly said that He was God. So don't be fooled by the people who want to twist around the words of the New Testament or who just ignore the words of the New Testament. So number one, you'll be doing it against the evidence. But here's the more important thing. Number two, if you try to just follow the example of Jesus, you will be greatly frustrated in your life. Because even though Jesus is our example, you can't follow Jesus' example unless He is also your Savior. Because we don't have the power to do that which He is calling us to do. That's why we sing songs like, "This is amazing grace." Because we need the grace of Jesus to carry out the life of Jesus. Caiaphas recognized beyond the shadow of a doubt that Jesus was exactly who Caiaphas thought He was claiming to be. But then look at how the story continues to develop. Pick it back up in verse 65. The high priest tore his robes and said, "He has uttered blasphemy. What further witnesses do we need?" Yet another example that He was willing to bend the truth and break the law, because at this point, Jesus has not said anything that would get Him condemned. The Mishnah, which is the first written version of the oral accounts of the Jewish law, the Mishnah clearly stipulates that no one can be held culpable for blasphemy unless they have uttered the very name of God. Now go back and read that passage on your own time and you notice who uttered the name of God and who didn't utter the name of God and who should have been guilty of blasphemy and who was not. But he says, this man is guilty of blasphemy. What other witnesses do we need? You have now heard his blasphemy. What is your judgment? And they answered him, he deserves death. In other words, Caiaphas and all of his religious crew shamefully rejected Jesus' majesty. They recognized it. They knew exactly who Jesus was claiming to be, and they just flat said, no thank you. We will have none of that. And so not only did they reject him, they shamefully rejected him. It says in verses 67 and 68, they spit in his face and struck him, and some slapped him, saying, prophesy to us, you Christ, who is that who struck you? They shamefully rejected Jesus' majesty. Don't fall into that camp. Recognize Jesus for who he is and give your life to him. Because he's the one who can give you more life than you could ever pursue for yourself. Do not reject Jesus' majesty. The fourth lesson that we can learn from Caiaphas drives us back to this idea of the divine plan. Caiaphas ironically validated Jesus' sovereignty. In all of these events, the irony is that he was seeking to maintain power. He was seeking to disqualify Jesus from power and authority, but ironically, in the midst of all that happened, as the events unfolded with the crucifixion, Caiaphas actually validated Jesus' sovereignty. Now, go back to John chapter 11 for just a moment. We read part of that passage. I want to read the rest of that passage. We read about, as it said in verse 47, these chief priests and Pharisees who gathered together and said, what are we to do? For this man performs many signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation. That was the collective thought. But listen to the specific thought of Caiaphas. Caiaphas said in verse 49, one of them, Caiaphas, who was high priest that year, said to them, you know nothing at all. Nor do you understand that it is better for you that one man should die for the people, not that the whole nation should perish. Wow. This is the non-believing in Jesus high priest, religious leader, saying it is better for you that one man should die for the people, not that the whole nation should perish. Then John gives us some commentary in verses 51. He didn't say this of his own accord, but being high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the nation, and not for the nation only, but also to gather into one the children of God who were scattered abroad. Caiaphas prophesied the benefit of Jesus' vicarious death. He was used by God in this position in which he was trying to get rid of Jesus. And in the very act of trying to get rid of Jesus, he prophesied the benefit of Jesus' vicarious death, his substitutionary death, his death that was for the benefit of us. Because we know, just as he prophesied, that it is better for one man to die for all the people than for all the people to perish. And church, that's the gospel right there. The gospel is that without Jesus, every one of us would perish. Because the Bible tells us that the wages of sin is death. And we all deserve death. We are all culpable. We all deserve punishment. But instead of having to stand before God and take our own punishment, Jesus took that punishment for us. And so Caiaphas prophesied the benefit of Jesus' vicarious death. Now go back to Matthew and fast forward to chapter 27. Notice what happens at the moment of the crucifixion, at the moment of Jesus' death. Pick up the action in Matthew 27, verses 50 and 51. Matthew tells us that Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. This is the moment in which Jesus' physical life came to an end. And behold, at that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn into from top to bottom. Now, if you're not familiar with how the temple was situated, the temple was basically the church of the people. That's where they went to worship. And the temple had several different components or parts to it. There was a part of the temple that only the Gentiles could only go in. The outer court of the Gentiles. And then there was an inner part where the Jews could go. But the very heart of the temple is what we call the Holy of Holies. That most holy place that only the high priest could enter into. And only him once a year. This was just as it says, the holiest of the holies. And it was separated with a curtain. As if to be a visible reminder that in there, that's where God dwells. That's where the presence of God resides, and you can't come in there. Just this one time a year, just this one guy, your highest official, he can only go in there once a year, but he can't just come in as he wishes. He has to come in because he has sacrificed the lamb. And thrown the blood on the altar. It is a visible reminder that access to the presence of God came at a price and was restricted. But notice what happened when Jesus died. Notice what happens at the moment of his vicarious death. The temple, the curtain of the temple was torn into from top to bottom. Now we don't know if Caiaphas was right there at the moment, but make no mistake, Caiaphas witnessed the results of Jesus' completed mission. He saw it. He saw it with his own two eyes. He saw what God was telling the people visually. He witnessed the results of Jesus' completed mission. The veil has been opened. Access to God has now been granted, and it hasn't been granted through you, Caiaphas. It's been granted because of our greater high priest, none other than Jesus of Nazareth, who has shed his own blood, that if we place our faith in him, if we trust him and surrender our life to him and accept that vicarious offering that he paid for us, then we too have access into the very presence of God. And Caiaphas witnessed those results. But church, it gets better. I can't make this stuff up. It's all in the book. You should read the book. It's a good book. Notice how the story continues to unfold. Fast forward to verse 62, still in Matthew 27. The next day, that is after the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate. And they said, "Sir, we remember how that impostor said while he was still alive, 'After 3 days, I will rise.'" Now, here's the irony of all ironies. Jesus' disciples didn't really remember that. And if they remembered it, they certainly didn't get it. They didn't understand it because they had this messianic misunderstanding. They never could conceive of a Messiah who would die. And because of that, this whole idea of a resurrection, of coming back after 3 days, just blew their mind because it didn't fit their picture. They had no category for a dead Messiah, and if you don't have a dead Messiah, you can't have a resurrected Messiah. So his disciples totally missed it, but his enemies didn't miss it. Now, they may not have believed it, but they remembered it, and they knew exactly where it could lead. If even the appearance of a resurrection was to get out. And so notice what they did. They go to Pilate and they said, "Listen, he said he was going to rise again. Therefore, order the tomb to be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples go and steal him away and tell the people he has risen from the dead, and the last fraud will be worse than the first." So Pilate, you got to do something. He says he's going to rise from the dead. Surely his disciples made note of that. They're going to try to take his body. They're going to try to carry out this resurrection hoax. So you need to put a guard at the tomb. And Pilate said to them, you have a guard of soldiers. Go and make it as secure as you can. So they went and made the tomb secure by sealing the stone and setting a guard. Listen to what Leon Morris said about this. They ensured there could be no nonsense about disciples stealing the body when Jesus did rise from the dead. The precautions of his enemies would underline the truth of his resurrection. So part three of him validating Jesus' sovereignty is that Caiaphas safeguarded the testimony of Jesus' miraculous resurrection. God used his arch enemy to safeguard the testimony of the resurrection. Because of what Caiaphas and his band of brothers did, their theory was proven to be false. They couldn't, with any sense of integrity, maintain that theory. But guess what? They still tried. And we still see remnants of that myth even to this day, even though Caiaphas safeguarded the testimony of Jesus' resurrection. Listen, if you're here this morning and you've heard all about Jesus, maybe you grew up in church. Maybe you're one of those people that you know this story. And you're even tempted to just kind of check out while we're talking about the life and death of Jesus because you've heard it so many times. But honestly, in the back of your mind, you've always been thinking, hey, it can't be. Hey, there's no way it actually happened that way. Let me challenge you with something. Rather than taking someone else's word about why they doubt that it happened, take some time to study the words of the people who actually saw it happen. And I bet your life will be different because of it. You can talk to people like Lee Strobel or Josh McDowell, who set out to prove for themselves that it was a hoax. They said, you know what, we're going to get to the bottom of this. So I know of a journalist, a scientist, and a criminal investigator who all set out to disprove this for themselves. And when they analyze the testimony, when they analyze the facts, when they see the difference that happens in the life of the disciples after the resurrection, they said, this is true. God used his enemies to safeguard his proclamation. This is how John MacArthur said it. The purpose of the Jewish leaders was to prevent a hoax. But the Lord's purpose was to take even their unbelieving antagonism and use it to prove the reality of Christ's resurrection and deity. Caiaphas, the very enemy of Jesus, validated his sovereignty. What about you? What are you doing with the reports of the sovereignty of Jesus? Are you going to continue to view him as just another teacher? As just a good example? As just a guy that has a message that our country and our community needs to hear right now? That if we just love one another and just all go along to get along, we'll all be a lot better off. That might have been included in Jesus' message, but it was not Jesus' message. His message was not try harder to do better. His message was not just love one another a little bit better. His message was, you have a price to pay because of the sin in your life, and I paid it for you. I died for you, and I rose from the grave, which shows that I am who I say I am, and I offer my life to you. What are you doing with it? Have you surrendered your all to the sovereignty of Jesus? Let's pray together.